Hello, in this video I will be telling you how I made the world's first 2 meter Rubik's Cube, but first a little history. In 2016 I set an official Guinness World Record with my 1.57 meter cube. I made it by extending one of these 18 centimeter mass produced 3x3s. In 2018 my record was broken by Wes Nelson in Canada with a 1.68 meter cube. Later in 2018 I made the world's largest 2x2 cube as a stepping stone towards breaking Wes Nelson's 3x3 record. Once again I used a mass-produced 18cm cube as a core. Although the giant 2x2 was a success, the parts were not good enough to be used for a 3x3, so I abandoned the project. In June 2019 I found out that a 30cm mass-produced Rubik's Cube was available, and that renewed my interest in regaining a record. I made a rough design for how I would extend a cube into a new world record. Initially I thought about a 6 foot cube, which is 1.83 metres. That seemed a bit feeble though, and eventually I went for the world's first 2 metre cube. I learned so many things from my previous world record, and this time I would make each cube in three parts. The outer large piece with embedded 40mm pipe, a modified cubey from the 30cm cube also with embedded pipe, and a separate piece of pipe running between the two, all held together with two standard plastic joins and metal bolts. This would give me maximum freedom for working on the parts, assembly, disassembly and any adjustments needed at the end. The mass-produced cube is very flimsy and fragile and needed a huge amount of modifying to make it stronger. Take this edge. You can see the embedded pipe with the join, but it has also been filled with rigid expanding foam and the bottom enlarged to avoid popping. The same has been done to the corner and similar things to the centres. The spider is far too weak, so I got this custom made by an engineer. This is how it looks with the centres attached. You can imagine how strong it is now, with the M6 threaded rod instead of the normal tiny screws. This process took many hours to complete. I was working on the largest Rubik's Cube in the world, but it didn't feel like it at this stage. As with my previous giant puzzles, I made the cubies from reinforced cardboard boxes. These came from Rajapak, a European company that specialises in packaging needs. They are sold as 65cm cubes, but that's the internal size. Because of the double flaps at each end, the external dimensions are 66x66x67. So to get exact cubes, I added 5mm thick cardboard to four sides. This results in 67cm cubes, which means the Rubik's Cube will be at least 2m1cm. As long as it's 2m or more, I don't care what the precise size is. Here are some of the materials I will be using. Most come from a regular DIY store and their purpose will become clear. This is one of six middles for the cube and I am finding the centre of it. Now I am gluing down the flaps to make one end secure. Using a drill and cardboard is overkill, but it was handy, so why not? I only need the hole to help find the centre of the side internally. Now I am removing the flaps from the other end, and then I will reduce the length of the box. The corners and edges will remain cubes, but the middles need to be cuboids. Attaching cardboard boxes securely to a 30cm plastic cube is more complicated than it sounds. I am embedding plastic pipe inside each cubie, so I have something solid to connect to. These weird crosses are designed so they won't move around inside the cubie. They are held in place with glue and then expanding foam. The foam also reinforces the boxes and needs to go along all edges. Even though I've cut down the boxes to make the middles, I still need to add the cardboard sheet to get the correct 67x67cm size. Now I am cutting an access point into the top of the cubie. Without this, it would be impossible to put the foam along every edge. In a moment, I'll cover the cubie with this black gaffer tape, but first, this is the best way to round the edges, though I bet they don't teach it in puzzle making school. The foam inside gets compressed and stops the cardboard from collapsing. The tape strengthens the cube further and gives it the nice black look you get on regular size puzzles. It's also quite smooth, which helps with the turning later. Now onto the edges. The process is very similar to the middles and will be again for the corners later. One difference though is that I'm adding two handles to each edge. These will make handling the final cube much easier. They will assist in making moves and flipping the puzzle over. It's hard to explain how I made the handles, so I'll just let you watch and it will gradually become clear. The rod is mounted back from the edge to allow for the rounding of the cubey. The actual holes will be the parts of it hidden by the orange quarter spheres. Holes will be cut in the box later, big enough for my hands to grasp the holes. The main 40mm diagonal rod attaches to the smaller one in a way so when using the holes to turn the puzzle over, the huge force goes into the centre of it. As well as reinforcing the box, the expanding foam holds the rods in place, but without needing to take the stress. Here is some batch foaming. As with the middle and corner, I need access to the inside when the other end is sealed. Last bit of foaming, and then the 5mm sheets to make it 67cm cubed. In order for the corner stems to move past the edges, I have to remove some of the cardboard and expanding foam. The cube is now covered in tape and I am ready to expose those holes. I'm using this guide to exactly locate them and make sure every cube looks the same. The tissue was supposed to stop too much foam filling the holes, but I still need to remove a lot. Cleaned up and a quick coat of paint, the holes are ready to be reinforced around the edges. I don't want any exposed cardboard, even if it's black. Right, that's the edges done, now onto the corners. More materials. I didn't purchase them all at once in case the project failed halfway through. As with the middles and edges, weirdly modified 40mm pipe is embedded into each corner. The ball keeps the pipe back from the very tip of the corner so the edges can be rounded. The ball is exactly the same type I used to make moulds for my giant Australopithecus balls. When set, I remove the ball and continue the expanding foam. Same routine as before, access hole and final expanding foam. 5mm cardboard, bashing and taping. No complicated holes to worry about, so pretty straightforward. To be honest though, it took a little bit longer than I've shown it here. With all the cubies made, it was now time to attach them. More 40mm pipe with standard couplings, though bolts are required to keep them in place. First chance for a movement test. I need to see if there are any major issues before I continue assembly. Nothing major, but the bolted joins allowed too much unwanted movement. So I drilled more holes and added pot rivets to three or four of the bolted areas on each cubie. The fourth area was left with just a bolt, so I could assemble and disassemble the cube without drilling out the rivets. This 6x13m tarpaulin gave me enough room to use a puzzle outside without damaging it or getting it dirty. I wanted to film the full assembly outside, but the weather wasn't cooperating. I used about 150ml of silicone lube on the internal 3x3 and the huge cubies. There was a fairly strict order for inserting the cubies. I needed to have room to put them in and also do up the bolts. This will be the blue and white edge. It has a special design and will always go in last and come out first. That's because the bolt that holds it in place can be reached through this hole, which is uncovered when the top is turned 45 degrees. Making and assembling the parts took 213 hours on top of the 85 hours for the core. Spare cardboard was used to make a giant wedge. This would help when turning the cube over. To help distribute the stress when turning the cube over, I also made these perspex rectangles. Assembly complete and time for a full test before doing stickers. You can see how I have made a dragging platform from the piece of tarpaulin I cut from the top right area. This avoids unnecessary wear and tear when removing it from my garage or putting it back in. Movement seems very good, better in fact than my 1m57 cube from 2016. Time to test another axis. The four perspex rectangles are inserted to distribute stress for the turnover. The wedge allows me to do the whole thing on my own. It took ages for me to work out how I could operate it alone, and the solution now seems so obvious. Despite being on uneven ground, movement was good on this axis too. I also tested a third axis. That was fine, so on to the stickers. These are 1mm sheets of high impact polished styrene that I got from Bay Plastics. I cut each sheet into six 56.5cm squares. Corners are rounded by first cutting and then filing to tidy them up. Double-sided tape is used to hold the stickers in place. final act of construction is to remove the protective cellophane from each sticker. Stickers had taken around 33 hours, making a total of 330 hours for the whole project. Once finished, I was eager to test it and make my first video. I did a standard checkerboard pattern to prove it worked, and everything was going great. When I came to undo the pattern though, this happened. One of the 30cm cube corner stems had broken. This was surprising since it was reinforced with resin. When I examined the piece, I realised that there was a 5mm gap that wasn't filled. I decided to drill holes through all the corners and use an inspection camera to see if the other 7 had gaps too. The others were fine, but to make sure, I put bolts through every one and poured resin around them. Now it really was finished, and the next day I did the checkerboard pattern twice to really make sure.